Hello guys, this is Indian Medico and in this video we are going to see about pelvic inflammatory disease or PID. This is a concise presentation for medical students. Pelvic inflammatory disease is infection of pelvic organs, that is, it is infection of female reproductive organs. PID results mostly from ascending infection through genital tract. The most common PID is salpingitis, that is, infection of fallopian tubes. Other forms of pelvic inflammatory disease includes endometritis, parametritis, oophoritis or infection of ovary, tubo-ovarian abscess and pelvic peritonitis. The incidence of PID is unknown because the diagnosis is often missed due to non-specific clinical features seen in PID. This picture shows a normal fallopian tube and a fallopian tube in case of pelvic inflammatory disease. As you can see, the fallopian tube is inflamed and there are adhesions. Pelvic inflammatory disease is most common in women between 18 to 25 years of age. It can occur earlier or later than this also. Now let us see about the etiology of pelvic inflammatory disease. The most common organism causing pelvic inflammatory disease is chlamydia. Almost 50% of cases of pelvic inflammatory disease are caused due to chlamydia. Other organisms causing pelvic inflammatory disease includes gonorrhea, bacterial vaginosis, atypical anaerobes, and tuberculosis. In most cases, a causative organism is not isolated in pelvic inflammatory disease. Now let us see about the pathophysiology of pelvic inflammatory disease. The infection is acquired through sexual contact. It is very rare in non-sexually active women. The patient may be asymptomatic for some years and PID is activated spontaneously or after instrumentation of uterus. This picture shows the pathogenesis of pelvic inflammatory disease. Sexually transmitted disease causing bacteria may enter vagina with semen. The bacteria may pass through cervix and enter uterus. The bacteria enters fallopian tubes and ovaries, which can become infected. The infection then leaves fallopian tubes and spread to other parts of body. Now let us see about the risk factors for developing pelvic inflammatory disease. Age less than 25 years, new sexual partner, lack of barrier contraception, use of combined oral contraceptive pills, insertion of intrauterine contraceptive device, and smoking are the various risk factors for developing PID. Now let us see about the clinical features of PID. The most common symptom is abdominal pain. If there is acute infection, the patient can present with fever, vomiting, anorexia, and malaise. There can be dyspareunia or painful sexual intercourse, postcoital bleeding, irregular bleeding, menorrhagia or heavy menstrual bleeding, dysmenorrhea or painful menstruation, discharge and back pain. Many women with PID are asymptomatic and PID is incidentally diagnosed at a later laparoscopy done for other causes like infertility. Now let us see about the examination of a patient with pelvic inflammatory disease. General examination should be done and the following things should be noted: temperature, pulse rate, blood pressure and signs of dehydration. Abdominal examination should be done. Tenderness can be elicited in abdominal examination. Speculum examination should be done. It might reveal discharge and abnormal bleeding. Bimanual examination should be done. The following things may be noted: cervical excitation, that is, pain on moving cervix from side to side, and adnexal tenderness. Pelvic mass, example, tubo-ovarian abscess may be palpable in some cases. This picture shows speculum examination findings in pelvic inflammatory disease. As you can see, there might be discharge and bleeding. Now let us see about the various investigations done for a case of pelvic inflammatory disease. Pregnancy test should be done to rule out ectopic pregnancy. High vaginal swab should be taken to diagnose Trichomonas vaginalis, Candida or bacterial vaginosis. Endocervical swab should be taken to diagnose gonorrhea or chlamydia, midstream urine should be collected and sent for microscopy and culture. Complete blood count and C-reactive protein should be sent. Blood urea and serum electrolytes should be sent if there is vomiting. Ultrasound should be done and it may reveal tube ovarian collection or free peritoneal fluid, which is a non-specific finding in pelvic inflammatory disease. Laparoscopy should be done if the diagnosis is unclear or if there is no response to treatment after 48 hours. This picture shows a normal laparoscopy findings. This picture shows laparoscopy findings in chronic pelvic inflammatory disease. As you can see, there are adhesions and there is inflamed fallopian tube. Now let us see about the differential diagnosis of pelvic inflammatory disease. The gynecological causes of abdominal pain includes ectopic pregnancy, miscarriage, torsion, rupture or hemorrhage of ovarian cyst, endometriosis, fibroid degeneration and ovulation pain. The non-gynecological causes of abdominal pain includes adhesions, appendicitis, urinary tract infection, pyelonephritis, constipation, irritable bowel syndrome, inflammatory bowel disease and gastroenteritis. All these conditions should be ruled out before diagnosing pelvic inflammatory disease. Now let us see about the management of pelvic inflammatory disease. Patient education is very important in pelvic inflammatory disease. She should be educated that pelvic inflammatory disease is an infection of pelvic organs and is generally sexually transmitted. The organism is often not identified and may have been asymptomatic in either partner for some time. So, the diagnosis of pelvic inflammatory disease does not necessarily imply recent infertility by either partner. Her partner will need testing and empirical treatment. She should not have sex until both she and her partner have completed treatment to prevent reinfection. The treatment is prolonged, but symptoms improve within a few days of starting treatment. She should come for follow-up after 48 to 72 hours to ensure improvement and for microbiology results. She should also come for follow-up 2 weeks after treatment has been completed for a full sexually transmitted infection screen to exclude any resistant infection. She should be educated that pelvic inflammatory disease increases the risk for chronic pelvic pain, ectopic pregnancy, and it may cause subfertility. She should be advised to use barrier contraception to prevent reinfection. Now let us see about the treatment of pelvic inflammatory disease. Analgesia, fluids and antibiotics should be given to the patient. The causative organism is not usually isolated. So chlamydia, gonorrhea and anaerobic organisms must be covered by the antibiotic regimen. Azithromycin 1 gram orally as a single dose or doxycycline 100 mg twice daily for 2 weeks plus ciprofloxacin 500 mg orally as a single dose or amoxicillin 2 gram orally as a single dose plus metronidazole 400 mg twice daily for 2 weeks should be given. If you notice, this covers chlamydia, this covers gonorrhea and this covers anaerobic organisms. IV antibiotics and fluids should be given if there is persistent vomiting, if the temperature is persistently higher than 38 degrees Celsius, if there is severe pain which is not controlled with simple oral analgesia, if the patient is unable to tolerate oral antibiotics and if there is no improvement after 48 hours of oral antibiotics. The IV regimen includes ciproxime 750 mg twice daily for 5 days plus metronidazole 500 mg 3 times daily for 5 days plus azithromycin 1 gram intramuscularly as a single dose or doxycycline 100 mg orally twice daily for 2 weeks. The regimen can be changed to oral antibiotics after 24 hours of systemic improvement and apyrexia. Now let us see about the surgical management of a case of pelvic inflammatory disease. Urgent laparoscopy is indicated if there is suspicion of ovarian torsion or if there is no improvement after 48 hours of IV antibiotics. The infected tubes appear red, inflamed, congested and exudative. Elective laparoscopy is indicated if there is persistent pain after completion of treatment. Elective laparoscopy should be done to rule out peritubal adhesions and perihepatic adhesions, which is seen in Fitz-Hugh-Curtis syndrome. Tubo-ovarian abscess can be managed conservatively initially. They should be subjected to drainage by laparoscopy or laparotomy if there is no improvement after 48 hours of conservative management. Intrauterine contraceptive device should be removed if it has been inserted recently or if there is severe infection. Now let us see about the complications of pelvic inflammatory disease. PID can lead to tubo-ovarian abscess, especially in anaerobic infections. It can lead to Fitz-Hugh-Curtis syndrome, which is due to perihepatitis resulting in perihepatic adhesions. Other complications include tubal infertility, ectopic pregnancy, and chronic pelvic pain. If you have any suggestions, please let me know in the comment section. For more such videos, please check out my gynecology playlist. Thank you.